Event-driven architecture is a common pattern found along microservices and other decoupled services or apps. In an event-driven architecture, each service in an ecosystem reacts and takes action upon an event it receives. There are both upsides and downsides of event-driven architecture, but before we get into that, let's take a look into an example of how event-driven architecture works so you know exactly what it is. Let's say we have a standard e-commerce system that allows users to purchase a product on a website. When a purchase is completed, a number of things need to happen. One, an email receipt should be sent to the purchaser. Two, inventory numbers should be updated to reflect that there are now less of the product available to purchase. Three, a fulfillment system needs to be notified so the purchased product can be shipped. And four, a purchase history should be updated for both the customer and the company to use for later reference. So it kind of looks like we need to have five services to make all of this work. One, the e-commerce system itself. Two, a service that sends emails. Three, an inventory control system. Four, a fulfillment service. And five, an order history. In a more traditional service-to-service direct communication architecture, the e-commerce service would complete the purchase with the customer, then a number of point-to-point calls would be made. It would call each of the other four systems, likely using like a REST API or something, to tell those services to complete their actions. Now, in an event-driven architecture, we would eliminate that point-to-point relationship between all these services. Instead, we'll introduce another service which we'll refer to as an event router. The event router can receive events from event publishers and it will push events to event subscribers. Now, there are many different brands of event routers out there and I'll talk to them in just a bit, but for now, let's just keep going with the example. So let's rearrange the diagram. In this new event-driven setup, the e-commerce system becomes the event publisher, and the four systems become the event subscribers. In this setup, the e-commerce platform no longer needs to make several outbound calls to each individual service with instructions on what to do. Instead, after the purchase is completed, it'll send an event to the event router. The event indicates that a purchase has been completed, as well as any other necessary details about the completed purchase that are necessary to allow other services to complete their task. After the event router receives the event, it pushes the event details to the event subscribers, or the subscribers pull the event from the router. Both options are usually available. When each of the four subscribers receive the events, they complete their necessary tasks and acknowledge to the router that they're done. At this point, the same outcome has been completed between these two different setups, but in slightly different ways. So now that you know the gist of what event-driven architecture is, let's discuss why you'd want to do this. After all, it kind of looks like I just added more complexity here because I added a sixth service to the stack. And you know what? You're kind of right. I did add another service here, but following this pattern has some huge upsides compared to the point-to-point method. I think the first thing we should discuss is how event routers and queuing services greatly reduce the possibility of system failures. In the example above, I kind of breezed through the part where the event subscribers acknowledge that they have completed their individual tasks. This feature is a key trait of event-driven architecture. You see, when the router receives an event, it knows which subscribers should receive that event and that it's critical that they acknowledge that they have completed their task. When the router attempts to send the event to the subscriber, if the subscriber doesn't reply back and say, "Hey, I'm all set here," the router will retry sending that event until it has been acknowledged. This means that one of your subscribers could be completely down for even an extended amount of time and still receive all the events when it comes back up, ensuring consistency between your systems. Most event routers even have the capability of reporting when an event fails too many times and it gives up on sending the event. This isn't ideal, but it allows for engineers to fix the issue and it also allows for manual remediation of the event that failed. Keep in mind that not all event routers are kind of created equal here. Some of them don't support this idea of subscribers and queuing of tasks as a service. I'll cover that a little bit later. So in the point-to-point approach, the e-commerce system would have to know how to handle failures and attempt to retry the API calls until it succeeds. If this is an extended amount of time, this could cause the e-commerce system to slow down or crash as it attempts to remember and retry all of these requests until they complete. This can cause slowdowns for the end user and even cause like a complete service failure. The second major advantage of an event-driven architecture is related to maintaining a decoupled relationship of microservices or separation of duties. Let's start on the publisher end. In our example, the e-commerce system's responsibility in this process is greatly simplified. All the e-commerce system needs to do here is publish a single event to the event router. It no longer needs to be concerned about what happens next. Because of this, we can now easily add additional subscriber to the system with zero changes to the e-commerce system. Let's say we wanted to create a service that alerts a store owner of a purchase via Slack. Well, that's no big deal now. Just add Slack as a subscriber to the event router and it'll start to receive events about the new orders. On the flip side of that, what if we wanted to completely replace the e-commerce system with something new. Well, as long as that new system can publish events about new purchases, zero changes need to be made to the subscribers. So there are pluses to event-driven architecture, but there are also some downsides. Probably the biggest downside to event-driven architecture is that everything is real-time. And while that can also be a plus, I'll explain where it causes a problem. Let's say that you want to introduce a system that maintains user profiles of your customers. You add the new service as a subscriber to your router, and now each new purchase shows up on the user's profile. Well, that's great, but what about the purchases they made last year? In this scenario, you need to do some additional work before you could just set it and forget it. You need to likely batch load all of the previous orders history into the new system and add it to the router so it can get the new orders. As you can see, it could take some planning to ensure that you get everything in sync, but moving forward, you'll enjoy the benefits of the event-driven architecture. So I promised earlier I'd cover the brands of event routers out there. As usual, all of the major cloud hosting companies have their own flavors of event routers. AWS has SQS and SNS. I'll put a link in the description so you can see the differences. It's mainly a difference of persistence and guaranteed delivery. Oftentimes, you may end up even needing both. GCP has PubSub, which is my personal favorite. It kind of combines both AWS services, and it also allows for multiple subscribers with guaranteed delivery in both a push or a pull setup. Beyond the cloud providers, there's also open source event routers out there. A couple of these are Apache Kafka, which is highly configurable, can do lots of fun stuff when configured correctly, and RabbitMQ, which I have honestly never used, but I didn't want to leave it out because it's a pretty well-known product in the space. So there you have it. That's everything you need to know to get started with an event-driven architecture. If you like this video, leave me a like, and if you have questions or comments, please leave them below. Until next time, happy coding.